Good afternoon, everybody. You are welcome to my presentation about wireless communication in smart goods or in energy data management, as it was mentioned in the course. Today, I will keep the talk not very technical in order to respect the other disciplinaries' nature of the course. So today, we'll talk about wireless communication in smart goods. What is the major need for the wireless communication in automation systems? In the beginning, I will start with some facts about wireless communication. So we know that wireless broadband networks have been now expanding dramatically in all dimensions. The number of connected devices to IP networks will be 3 times larger than the number of a global population by 2020. So you can see that how much it will involve in our life. During the last year, 2016, the total IP traffic was surpassed 1.1 zettabyte. Zettabyte is 1 billion terabyte or 1,000 billion gigabyte. So it is very, very huge. And maybe it is more interesting for us that more than two-thirds, about 70% of this total IP traffic in 2020 and beyond will be handled by the last mile by wireless transceiver. Last mile means that either in the beginning or in the receiving part. So it will be involved by wireless transceiver, wireless network. So we can see now the role of wireless communication in every aspect of life. So we can see that IP traffic includes many different applications, such as beside our daily use, our mobile phones, social media, but also in smart cities, in wireless automation, in e-government, in military, smart homes, remote monitoring and control, e-health and safety application, actually many, many applications, yes, please.
For the audience, IP network, I guess it means internet.
Internet protocol, yes.
Internet protocol.
Yes. So we can see here the transition of mobile networks or wireless networks in terms of the speed of the data. We can see that from 1991 up to 2000, about 10 years. So actually at that time, they were not that much development. So it was the data about 9.6 kilobits. By 2000, it was in commercial use about 14 kilobits per second. When I came to Finland in 1999, it was 9.6 kilobits per second that you can get out of your mobile phone when you connect it to your computer. But you can see that 10,000 later, about 2010, the data rate becomes around 40 megabit per second, from 14 kilobit per second or in the downlink or uplink 14 up to 43 megabit per second. It means that more than 2,000 times more, which gives us the huge progress in that sector. And actually the progress is continuing. So you can see that we continue now with the LTE, that we can get up in the downlink up to 300 megabit per second, going to 3 gigabit per second, and also beyond to the 5G, where we can get even more data rate. In communication, for those who are outside from the area, that simply we can manage, or we can give it in this picture, that we have the data that we want to transmit, we have the transmitter, which prepare the data format to be able to go through the channel. The channel can be wireless or wireline till the receiver. And then the receiver should recover the signal to be as the same or very close to the way that it was transmitted, the original signal. Of course, we have many limitations that makes this as a challenge. For example, we have the channel losses, we have distortion in the channel, we have interference from different many other transmitters, we have noise signal everywhere in this stages. To see the difference between wireline channels and wireless channels, for example, in the wireline we have the twisted pair, as in conventional telephone. We have coaxial cables, like in the TV cables, cables. We have also waveguides. We have fiber optics. All those are some a few kinds of wireline channels. In wireless channels, of course, it's wireless, so it is mainly used for broadcasting, like in the radio, TV, and GPS, or in multi-user communication, like in mobile networks and Wi-Fi. What are the differences between wireline and wireless? What they are, mainly the advantages and disadvantages. So the advantages of wireline, for example, it has higher security because you have connecting cable between the transmitter and the receiver. So the intercept of this cable is limited. Of course, it is possible, but it is limited, not like wireless, where that just you propagate your signal, so it is very difficult to keep the security in that case. It is low to very low signal losses in the wire line. For example, fiber optic, it is very low signal losses. And but there are also some disadvantages, like higher installation costs. I do remember that in this traffic close to the university, where they were changing the light of the traffic, there's a lot of civil instruction in order to have the cables. So the cables, usually it has much higher installation costs. Connects between fixed terminals to restricted mobility. This is also a limitation for the wire line. The channel is static, not a lot of dynamics and uncertainty, so it is benefit. A small fluctuations, it is also benefit for the signal amplitude at the receiver. For the wireless, it is less secure, so this is one of the disadvantages. Very high signal losses, so that higher transmit power is needed, another disadvantage. But also, lower installation costs. Just you put your transmitter and receiver, so it is wireless, so it is much easier. And also free mobility, easier for the configuration. For example, if you have in factory, you want to change things, it is very easy to change because you don't need to change all cables connected there. Highly dynamic and uncertainty. There's a lot of uncertainty in the channel, so it is one of the disadvantages in wireless communication. And large random fluctuations means that the packet might lost easily. Okay? You can see now, this is the wire line, how they are. So if there's some fault here, it is not that easy to find. And also it takes a lot of time in order to fix things as this person doing now. But if it is wireless, for example, if you have transmitter, now that transceivers in wireless, they are quite cheap. I mean, it can cost a few euros. So if it is fault, then just change it and replace it with another transceiver. So it is much easier in that case. However, in wireless communication, we have many problems, many challenges. One of the most challenging problem is the scarcity of the spectrum. The spectrum is not infinity. Don't think that it is free, that you can just plug your transceiver and put antenna and transmit. No, it is not in this way. It is very difficult. You can see this is, for example, United States, that all band is already licensed. So you cannot just transmit. So you have to have some bandwidth, some spectrum in order to transmit your signal. But it is not free because most of the band is licensed already. Some companies or some services used to pay like billions of euro in order to license a certain band. So it is not easy to have. Of course, there are few bands which are free, but they are very small bands, and it is called ISM bands, and the interference level is high at those bands. So it is not easy to find, so you have to use within the band that it is given from the regulator. There is a bandwidth or spectrum regulators in every country. Also, we have another problem in wireless communication, like high losses in the channel, as we mentioned before, fading because of multipath, fading behavior is uncertain due to the time-varying nature of the channel. So the channel is time-varying. The channel now is not the channel after few seconds. So the channel is changing very fast. We have additive background noise makes the detection of the signal much more challenging. Interference from other users of the channel. So we have many challenges in wireless communication. It is important to mention those challenges later on to see the impact of that challenges on automation. This is just a general picture about the signal, how the signal will arrive to the, from the transmitter to the receiver through many paths. This is just, it shows how the actual signal power at the receiver. So you can see from this part, from this level to this level, it is about minus 40 dB. 40 dB means that the signal power drops 10,000 times when you're moving the transmitter by a few centimeters. So the signal power can drop 10,000 times, which means that it is possible that the packet is lost. So in order to dimension, or in order to assess the quality of the channel or the communication link, we need to define some list. It is called quality of service. The quality of service list includes communication reliability, security, outage probability. Outage probability is the percentage where the link is off. It is like when you look to your mobile phone and you find that there is no connection. Or when you try to call someone, then you get error message, so you cannot connect to the internet, to the network. So it is called probability of outage. Communication performance in terms of throughput. Throughput means the speed of data, okay, of real information. Packet loss. Packet is the packet of data when you send. So lost, it means that what is the probability that you send packet, but the packet is not receiving because of some reason. Okay. Delay. This is actually, the delay is very important in automation application. Because, for example, if you have some very sensitive action that you are monitoring, and there is something wrong happen, like a bowel network, then you need to take very fast action. Sometimes the delay cannot be more than a few milliseconds, because it is too late if you send after that. So delay is very important aspect in wireless communication that we need to take care about. Delay spread. Delay spread is the difference between maximum and minimum delay. So sometimes you send some packet, and next packet arrived before the first one because the delay is not the same for the transmitting packets. Bit error rate, the error of the transmitted data. We have communication cost and priority. So we have several kind of quality of service parameters we need to see and to know in order to select the proper one for our automation application. A real-time data stream, so we have different kinds of services like live audio, live video, and we have automation application. This is an important thing in this lecture. So we have sensors, data, actuator commands, monitoring, and also we have non-real-time data stream like internet exploring and file down or uploads. We have different kinds of communication network like direct connection, point-to-point, start connection, point to multi-point, like in cellular network. In mobile network, we have the base station, we have several mobiles, so we have such kind of communication. And we have like ad hoc network, it is called mesh network, multi-point to multi-point. We have several protocols which control every kind of those communication technologies. Now we go to that, after this introduction about communication, we come to the major or the core topic. In this picture taken from this website, they talk about smart field. In this smart field, for example, we have several equipments, and they are connected by wireless communication. As you can see here, we have motion detection, night vision camera, we have some process going on here. We have sensors everywhere, like a wheel head sensor. We have also sensors here for this wheel, one, and so on. And all this data is gathered together and then transmitted over wireless network, and it can be, it can go through the internet protocol, IB, and then you can follow what is going on remotely, even for on your mobile phone or computer, or even you can take actions, remote control actions from wherever you are. In smart grids, we have, I will not talk about smart grids itself because it has been already done before, but we can just see these pictures that we have several kind of generators, like renewable generators. We might have some plants, and we have monitoring and control room. And then it becomes easier if you have wireless connection between all these items together, and in order to achieve the objectives of the network. Not only to connect between equipment, but also inside the plants or inside the equipment. For modern power plants, it might contain up to, well, from 1,000 up to 5,000 sensors inside the plant itself, the generator, for example. And in that case, because this, we have sensors for vibration, we have sensors for temperature, we have sensors for speed, we have sensors for humidity, we have some sensors for corrosion, for many, many sensors inside the plants. And currently, most of those sensors are connected by wire lines. So wireless also can be one solution in the future, about, because they can reduce the price, they can reduce their maintenance time, they have many other features to use wireless instead of wireline, as we can see here. All those many, many wiring for just kind of small portion of sensors inside the plant. Generally, communication, we have a communication part and automation part. In communication part, we have transmission power, modulation and coding, communication protocols, scheduling, data rate, and so on. And those communication parameters, they will have impact on the automation side, which is feedback delays, system stability, system performance, and usability. So this is the automation side, and this communication side, they are very interrelated to each other. Okay, this is one challenge about the control design in wireless communication case. Now, the application of communication in smart systems. Let us talk a little bit about smart system. Generally, smart cognitive system, what we mean by smart cognitive system? Smart cognitive system is any system is able to sense the environment and then get data about the environment. Then they can have optimal reaction, not necessarily optimum, maybe sometimes we need only satisfied reaction for these measurements from the outside. And after that, they can learn from their action. When they take the action to the plant, then they assess what have been the response, and then they can learn, they can improve itself, it can adapt with time. Okay, this is the smart and cognitive system in general. So you can see here, for example, in this picture, that we have the objectives, the criteria, constraints, utilities, any extra information needed. This is the heart of the learning process in the system. But we need information about the environment. So we have sensors. And the environment itself is a dynamic process, can be very, very complicated system. And it is also time varying, so it changes with time. And then we collect data. We need communication, then data collection. From the data collection to the data processing, we need communication. From the data processing to the reasoning, machine learning, optimization, we need also communication. And then the heart of the intelligent system, it will give the rules which should be done. We need communication to the decision maker. The decision maker takes the optimal solution or the satisfied solution based on those rules. And then we need communication to the response, which is the actuation. Then we need communication as well. And we take the action to the plant. And based on the action, we sense what happened. And then we can learn. The system can learn with time, and it can be more expert with the environment.
Excuse me?
Yes.
So that at the low, it is what happens in physical life.
Exactly.
And there are sensors that take information, and the response actuation affects the real
exactly.
life.
Exactly. Those here, we might have also people. It is not only just machine. It can be people. The people impact can be here as well. So it is very interact with people. For example, for this the car without drivers right now, which are in the street. So, for example, it is already augmented with many sensors to see the situation of the street. But what happened if this car, when it was moving, it saw ball? Okay. So, what action it can take? For us human, directly you think that there should be person, maybe child, behind some car, so we take care. So, but in that case, this environment, it might be affected by even the some unpredictable behavior of people. So how can we take this into consideration in smart system? Yes.
Yes, and this Jouni Lampinen's presentation about optimization is critical because you may optimize how this car without driver, where it goes.
Yes. Actually, sometimes it is not optimizing because the optimum, what Jouni was talking about, global optimum. Well, and the global optimum, as he mentioned, can take very long time. I mean, because there are many, many aspects to take into account, and this optimization, in order to have the global solution, maybe takes generations.
Okay. But to avoid collision,
yes,
you need to
Take fast action sometime, and fast action means that you need to have satisfied solution, not necessarily to be the optimum solution. Looking for the optimum solution can take very, very long time, sometimes many hours in order to, not many hours, sometimes can be years of computer to.
Anyway, it is algorithm.
It is algorithm, yes, it is algorithm, and you can find the optimum or the satisfied reaction.
Yeah.
Okay. And systems of systems, it is also just a topic about systems of systems. For example, city can be seen as a system of system because city is a system but contains smart grid. So smart grid is a subsystem of that bigger system. And also we have traffic lights, it is another system. People is another system. So the city can be seen as system of many other systems. And optimizing every system separately maybe is not the optimal solution. Looking to this big picture about systems of systems and how to make some cross-layer optimization between different systems together, we might have much more efficient solutions. For example, you can see this is mesh of fishes. This is one example about system of systems because those meshes, those fishes, they can move together and then we have some kind of distributed intelligence in this case. It is one of the things that they are under study now about how those thousands of small fishes move together and they can react almost at the same time. What kind of distributed intelligence that they have. Okay, smart grids. Smart grids, we know that from the previous lecture of Dr. Artuati, I think. When he talk about smart grids, he might talk about the benefits of using smart grids, like enhancing energy efficiency, reducing operational costs, increase reliability, reduce the pollution of integrated, by integrating distributed renewable energy. And we have these energy layers. This is our vision about energy layers, that we have the generation, and we have the resources, generation, distribution to the customer, and then users, and those users are impacted by politics, by social system, by marketing, pricing, many, many other things. We have the control, we have the protection, we have cross-layer optimization, decentralized control, multi-agent control, and conflict of interest that also needs study, that we can use game theory, for example, to check or to study this or investigate the conflict of interest, for example, by owners of those several layers. Smart grids, real-time information availability is a critical requirement in smart grid. And now we have communication. This is the why we need communication, because real-time information is critical in order to success or to have successful operation of the smart grid. So what the information sources? We need information from generation, distribution, load sites, weather and environment impact, from the market, from politics, from social impacts. So we have many different kind of information that we need to collect together in order to operate the smart grids. So the measuring point in the smart grid is a smart meter. This is for the technical information. The technical information source is a smart meter. Smart meter is a device which can measure the power, okay, like power meter, either DC or AC, and then they can transmit those information to the distributed control system and to the power management. At the same time, this smart meter, it can connect to the customer devices. So it can connect either by wire or wired line or wireless. For example, using Zigbee or Bluetooth or Wi-Fi, it can be connected to your washing machine, refrigerator, and to, for example, air condition and so on. And in that case, this is actually one thing that can be used in this. It was in the program that in the first lecture, first presentation today.
Energy informatics.
Yes, yes. In that system, for the first presentation today, that given.
Today.
In the yes. For this, in the actually, if they can use this smart meter, then there is no need to just someone to enter the information, because they can be connected to every light lamp inside the school or to everything. So it can be connected directly and they can control them. If there is no lecture in this class, so automatically by smart system, they can be switch off the lights, for example, and shut down the air condition, for example.
There is need for any tool.
Yes, yes, based on this smart meters, yeah. Yes, yes. And about communication in smart grid, this is maybe the last slide.
5 minutes, I guess.
Yes, yes, good. So in the smart grid communication manifestation, we might have wired line or wireless. For wired line, we might have fiber optic. Power line carrier is using the power cable in order to send communications or information over them, but they are quite limited, especially for the large distance. We have Ethernet and DSL. This is for the wireline. For the wireless, we can divide them into two parts, like wide range, like wide area network, and short or medium range local area network. For this local range, we might have standalone system or third party. Standalone means that the owner of the system is using his own communication equipment. They don't need third party, like for example, Elisa or some other, like cellular network operator, for example. Okay, so here the standalone, like Wi-Fi, you can use your own Wi-Fi in order to get communication. Bluetooth, Zigbee, ultra wideband, point to point light links, like LED, RFID, near field communication. All these protocols can be used because they are already available protocols. So people can just, in automation, they can use those solutions and they are more secure here because you don't need third party. The third party solution, like machine to machine and device to device communication under 5G. This is one of the new protocols now that you can, all it is access proposed, not yet in the market, but you can use devices to directly communicate to each other under the supervision of the like cellular network. So for example, you have two devices, they can sense each other, so they are in the same coverage area, so that the cellular network can monitor the communication performance, and in that case, we can reduce the latency and the delay inside this system. For the wide range communication, we might have also a standalone solution and third party solution. Third party solution is by using cellular network, for example, SMS messages or GPRS, like GSM, 3G, LTE, 5G, satellite. And for the standalone communication, we might have also private networks like Tetra, WiMAX when it is private, point-to-point microwave links, private satellite transporter, and so on. So actually, those are different solutions that we have to achieve wireless communication in automation applications. Okay, again, just about the major points here. Coverage area distance, it is short if it is less than 25 meters. It is medium if it is less than 200 meters. Wide if it is more than 200 meters. Very general, you might find some differences in literature about the definitions of the distances. Very fuzzy. Throughput is the communication speed. Latency is critical for the fast control and the protection application. It is the delay. Security issues depends too much on the application. Cost, about the license, operation, installation, maintenance, first costs, and so on. Reliability and maintaining period. Owned or third party. Reconfigurability of the system, standardized or special solution. And the last thing that I just took very briefly is the cybersecurity challenges. Actually, it is one of the most critical and challengeable parts in smart grid, because smart grid is open system. So you know that if attacker was able to intercept inside the power plant or the power system, how much loss can happen. For example, if he or she was able to make like blackout in big city, it can cost billions beside the safety and security issues. So it is one of the very critical challenges now, and there's a lot of research going on to achieve like acceptable level of safety for the cybersecurity in smart grids and the future power grids. That's all for today, and thank you for listening.
Okay. So questions, audience questions.
Yes.
You have small such topic discussed.
We have actually tens of topics. So in every part here, we can, for example, smart grid, we might generate like many masterpieces topics or topics for this course. Yes, so you, actually in every slide here, you might find interesting topic that you can go in. Actually, this slides, I reduced them from one day seminar. It was about wireless automation. It was a few years ago. So I have the whole, it was about 120 slides. So if you're interested, I can also send them to you.
Okay, he asked the question that I was to ask. But anyway,
yes.
Other questions? One example was this cyber security threats. That's one possible topic for your mini study in this course or master's thesis, for example.
Yes, you can study, for example, the impact. The impact of that.
Yeah.
Threats,
and,
yes.
And what kinds of there yes. are, for example, and.
Yes, for example, from those who study IT or computer science, they can study also the types of threats that we have, like the security attacks types and how to avoid them. For those from more in non-technical side, they can talk about the impacts on the social system or about these threats in this social, cybersecurity problems. This is systems of systems, like distributed intelligence. I have one PhD student working on this distributed intelligence, which is very interesting as well. So actually we have many
you need to browse the slides and find if you want to do your mini study from this scientific viewpoint that Elmostrati represents, so you can see the slides.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Let's
give
hand for that.